The junkyard gaze. Who is this man that he can see value in me? Who is this man that he can hear the plight that I plead? Yeah. Took me inside and fixed me up with new parts and supplies.
Good morning, Hope. How are you today? Good. My name's Josh, and I just want to welcome you. Thank you for coming today. It's a joy to be with you. And we're going to sing some songs this morning about God's faithfulness, about expecting Christ's return. And one of the songs we're going to sing is called "Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus." It's a beautiful old hymn, but there's a verse in it that can be a little confusing if you haven't spent a lot of time in church. And so before we get to that song, I just want to talk about it so you know what it means. The verse talks about trusting in Jesus' cleansing blood, and then there's a line that says, "In simple faith to plunge me 'neath the healing cleansing flood." And you know, in the 21st century, that sounds a little weird, thinking about being washed by the blood of Jesus. And the reason for that is a kind of poetic device that, you know, as Christians, we believe that through our sin, we've been separated permanently from God and from his love. We deserve actually to not be with him, but to be apart from him. And we believe that Jesus, by his sacrificial death on the cross, paid the price for that sin so that we could be reunited with him. And so when we talk about the blood of Jesus in Christian music, what we're talking about is this feeling of thanksgiving that we have for Christ's atoning and sacrificial death, that we can be united with God because of the beautiful work of Christ on the cross. And that the more that we ponder that and reflect on that, it actually becomes this beautiful and wonderful thing. So I just wanted to explain that a bit. So if you haven't spent much time in church, hopefully that helps explain why we sing those verses. But we'll get to that song in a minute. We're going to sing some others before that. So would you stand with me and read this call to worship together from Psalm 138. I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I sing your praise. All right, let's give thanks to God for his steadfast love. Let's exalt him today. One, two, three, one, two, three. Christ is my firm foundation. The rock on which I stand, when everything around me is shaking, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. I've still got joy.
I've still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense, so I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength, 'cause I built my life on Jesus. No, he's never let me down. He's faithful in every season. So
with me. Rain came.
Rain came and wind blew. My house was built on you. I'm safe with you. I'm gonna make it through.
Rain came. Faithful through the ages. He hasn't failed yet, and he won't start now.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the great a mercy. What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin. Has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my began to breathe. Hallelujah. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me.
Then came the morning.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Declared the grave has no claim on me. Hallelujah. Praise the to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Oh, how sweet.
Oh, how sweet.
Yes, 'tis sweet.
And yes, 'tis sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease, just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and joy. Precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that thou art with me, will be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Sing Jesus.
Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, for grace to trust him more.
Lord, we do ask you for grace to trust you. We know that you are an all-powerful God, that you are a good God, that you are an infinitely wise God. We also know that you know our hearts and our lives and each chapter of our story. And what an amazing combination that is, Lord, that we have an all-powerful God who knows us intimately and wants our good. Lord, the author and perfecter of our faith. So, Lord, would you give us grace to trust you today? Lean on you, not on our own understanding. To find wisdom in the Bible, in your word. To come before you in prayer and ask for your aid. To trust your words even when we don't agree with them. And I pray that we would find that it is so sweet to trust in you. Have the cares taken away, Lord, to come before you because your yoke is easy and your burden is light. Would you give us grace for that today? Amen.
Good morning. For those who don't know me, my name is Travis, and I'd like to just say welcome, and we're so glad that you're with us this morning. Our vision here at Hope East Village is to bear witness to the kingdom of God by seeking the flourishing of the East Village, the Lower East Side, and all of New York City. One thing that we like to do each week is to take a moment to greet one another and to welcome one another into this space. You can leave your pews or turn to someone near you and say hello. So we'll take a few minutes to do that, and then I'll gather everyone back together for announcements. I'd like to welcome you back to your seats. For those of you who are visiting for the first time, I just want to say welcome again and to welcome you guys back to your seats. Yeah, keep the tambourine. No, it's okay. Okay. Along the pews in front of you, we'll continue on with announcements. Thank you. Along the pews in front of you, you'll find a Connect card that you can fill out and either drop off in the box in the back or hand to me. This is just some basic information to allow us to reach out to you and to help you get more connected and plugged into our community. We have a few announcements for you today. One is that the 11th Street Community Garden, which is located right next to the church, is hosting Community Day on August 13th from 2 to 6 p.m. Our church is going to be giving out backpacks and other school supplies to our neighbors to start off the back-to-school season. If you're interested in helping out with school supply distribution or you have any questions about the event, you can speak to Sharon, who will be helping to organize that. Now, I'd actually like to invite Sharon and Bill up to give another announcement about some very cool things that are happening at our church.
Well, just like many of you, for the last few months, Sharon and I had been sitting comfortably in our pew, really just minding our own business, and that's when it started to happen. Every week we would hear these announcements about how a new book club was forming, but not just that, how this book club was being hosted by Bill and Sharon Westroth. And so a few Sundays ago, during one of these announcements, I turned to Sharon and I'm like, have you heard about this book club? And she said, no, but listen, if it's being announced from the stage of the Hope Village Church, it must be truth. So I couldn't argue with that, so I went home, ordered the book, and had been frantically reading for the last few weeks so I could report back to you. The book is called Reparation, and it's really a book about the complicit role of the church in and its response to theft. Theft of truth, theft of power, theft of wealth. And it really explores this very painful and complex issue under the hot white light of the Good Samaritan parable. As you know, the Good Samaritan wasn't just some nice guy who stopped and acknowledged theft, but really someone Jesus used to model for us what it looks like to be engaged in the healing and repair process. So I'm going to turn it over to Sharon for a few details, but before I do that, I just wanted to finish by strongly encouraging you not to come to book club. Don't come. And I say that because I know you guys. Many of you are young New York professionals who just struggle under the weight, the stress and strain of new jobs, of your careers. And the last thing you need right now is this space of disorientation and disruption. So I totally get that. I totally get it, but for the few of you who may be called, feeling that pull into the deeper call of Christ, into the space of disorientation and disruption, I would encourage you not to enter that space alone, but do it in community, where together we can support, we can learn, we can grow, and hopefully even make it through to the other side and be formed into a kinder, more gentle, more compassionate people, perhaps even just better prepared to do the work that Christ is calling this community into.
So I'm going to encourage you to come to book club. So we look forward to beginning this adventure with you, creating new space to learn together, to listen, to explore, to pray, and then seek out engagement, to learn from our time what moral imagination, civic discourse, social healing, and response can look like, and how we can practice this with our whole being. So the plan is to meet on Saturday mornings from 10 to 12 noon in person, beginning on September 10. And then we'll continue meeting every other Saturday. So please take a picture of the book, because that is the book we'll be reading together, and save the date, September 10 at 10 a.m. Thank you.
Thanks, Bill and Sharon. As you can tell, they're absolutely delightful people. I get the privilege of learning from them every week in home group. So sometimes I figure out, do I want to come? Do I not want to come? I ask them for advice, and it doesn't help. But I would also encourage you to go. Not that I'm actually leading this, but they are amazing, and I think that the book is going to be meaningful and challenging, but also very healthy and good. So now we'll transition into a time of giving. For those of you who'd like to give, we have a number of ways up here on the screen for you to do so. If you're new to this community, please feel no obligation to give. We're just so glad that you're with us, and I just want to say thank you. Each week, we read this liturgy together as a reminder of our value of living generously. Would you read along with me?
Godliness with contentment is great gain. We bring nothing into this world, and we take nothing out of it. We who call Jesus Lord devote ourselves to resisting greed, which plunges the human heart into ruin and pierces it with many griefs. We are determined to practice generosity with free hearts, fixing our hope on God and not the uncertainty of wealth. We desire to be rich in good deeds and willing to share all that we have, laying up for ourselves treasure that will not decay, but will shine in the age to come. Amen.
Of eternal promise, stirring in your sons and daughters, earth revealing heaven's wonders. Spirit come, Spirit come. What you spoke is now unfolding. Your children shall behold it. Dreams awaken in this moment. Spirit come, Spirit come. Pour it out, let your love run over. Here and now, let your glory your presence, and the His power is within us, and we will rise to be a witness. Spirit, come, Spirit, come. Pour it out, let your love run over. Here and now, let your glory as we hold to this assurance. Spirit, come. Spirit, come. Spirit, come.
Spirit, come. Pour it out. Let your love run.
Join me in reading the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Hi. As Pastor Drew is on sabbatical this summer and Pastor Chelsea is on maternity leave, we are excited to have a series of guest speakers joining us over the next weeks. Today we have the privilege of hearing from Leisha Epperson. Leisha is a graduate of Union Theological Seminary and received her Master of Arts in Ministry from General Theological Seminary. She is a candidate for ordination in the Episcopal Diocese of New York. Leisha is a professionally trained dancer who has taught dance to hundreds of children in the New York City public school system and brings to her ministry work a love for the creative and performing arts. More recently, she founded the Creative Arts Project, a free arts enrichment program for children at All Souls Church Harlem. Leisha and her husband, Rodney, are native New Yorkers and parents to five beautiful children. Leisha will be sharing from us from the book of Luke, chapter 12, verses 32 to 40. If you are able to, please stand for the reading of the word. Luke chapter 12, verses 32 to 40. Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give alms. Make purses for yourselves that do not wear out, an unfailing treasure in heaven, where no thief comes near and no moths destroy. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Be dressed for action and have your lamps lit. Be like those who are waiting for their master to return from the wedding banquet, so that they may open the door for him as soon as he comes and knocks. Blessed are those slaves whom the master finds alert when he comes. Truly, I tell you, he will fasten his belt and have them sit down to eat, and he will come and serve them. If he comes during the middle of the night or near dawn and finds them so, blessed are those slaves. But know this, if the owner of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. Now I'd like to invite you to take a brief minute of silence before a sermon in order to recognize God's continued presence with us and to prepare our hearts for what God wants to speak to us through Scripture.
So good morning, Hope Church East Village. My name is Leisha Epperson, and I am a daughter, a sister, friend, now mother of five, a woman of God, and a wife of 26 years. And I come to you today from St. Peter's Chelsea and bring greetings from them to you. I come to you today in the fullness of who I am, with an awareness of having the privilege to speak into this moment, a moment of uncertainty, of anxiety and questions, wonderings. And within that, we have people of faith like you and me, wrestling with how to be believers in what I'll loosely call, very loosely call, a post-pandemic world. Because things have changed, haven't they? They have and continue to do so. So I ask God to speak through me, using the time I've spent in prayer and meditation on the scriptures to share a word of hope, something meaningful, something useful this Sunday morning. And so I ask you to bow your hearts with me in prayer. God, Creator, Redeemer, Sustainer, draw near right now. Amen. There is a lot going on in the world today. Suffering is everywhere. Behind many of our smiles is the truth and challenge of a deeply seated disorientation, a future unknown, a growing hopelessness and fear. Like the disciples, we want to know how to move forward. If there is anything we need to know and do right now. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give alms. Be dressed for action." So what of this being dressed for action, this selling and giving, and what is the kingdom? How do we hear Jesus' words and apply their meaning today? From Galilee, Jesus and the disciples are making their way slowly toward Jerusalem. This is a critical time, and when Jesus speaks, he does so with a sense of urgency. The parables, Jesus' stories, are told and discerned as exhortation and warning to the people he loves. These things are the things you need to know as you make your way in a changing world. The Message translation reads thusly, "What I'm trying to do here is get you to relax. Not be so preoccupied with getting so you can respond to God's giving. People who don't know God and the way he works fuss over these things. But you know both God and how he works. Steep yourself in God reality, God initiative, God provisions. You'll find all your everyday human concerns will be met. Don't be afraid of missing out. You're my dearest friends. The Father wants to give you the very kingdom itself." Much of what Jesus shares in our scripture verses for today can be broken down to three things. Jesus speaks to the coming crisis and sets forth a pathway to peace by naming the problem of fear. Relax, stop, or do not be afraid. Give, put others first, think collectively and not selfishly. And he says, be on your post. With this coming change, you will have to be ready, prepared, here not for judgment or punishment, but to receive or be a witness to this good thing, the kingdom, the dream of God. In this sense, being ready is less about any actual time and place and more about imagining and noticing Jesus' activity in the world, mostly when and where we least expect it. Be ready. God doesn't want you to miss any of it. Jesus drills down on this new way of living and being. He crafts a new story, one that resists fear. So remember, right after that command to not be afraid, he offers a promise. I'm going to give you the kingdom. And he encourages a balanced attitude toward possessions, our faithful contribution to the flourishing of all. Be ready, he says, by practicing this way of being that leaves you open to receive all that is good. You'll almost certainly be surprised by it. This is how we walk forward toward a hopeful future, toward God's kingdom of love. And none of this is new. God has always called us to a different way of being, and we have a reminder of it in Jesus' words today. I'm convinced the kingdom is not something we have to grasp at with unrelenting, greedy fingers, but something we receive and become, something we align our hearts with, conform to. Jesus proposes the kingdom not as a possession, but as a new way of being, steeped in God reality, trusting in God's initiative and provision. God's desire is that we experience it. We are always and forever walking towards change, but as the world changes, these teachings hold true. We may gather in different ways to hear them, even explore new ways to experience them, but the plan and reminder remain a useful strategy to help us through the hard parts of life. They are basic, a basic mode of spirituality, and they work. So Jesus begins here, stop being afraid. A life of fear is no life at all. Decisions made based in fear and anxiety will destroy us. Fear will keep us frozen. So let's talk about fear. Significant to the end of fear is the naming of it. The disciples want to know what's on the other side of this absolutely coming revolution. Making the choice for Jesus has made them targets for persecution. Will it cause them to lose their lives? They need to know. Jesus presses them toward confidence in a God whose pleasure is to provide for them, moving them from fear to confident reassurance, or at least the kind of stubborn curiosity that keeps them moving along. At the heart of God's kingdom are truth, peace, justice, and reconciliation. It is God's desire that we have and experience this, but we can't have any of it if we are afraid. Being free from fear means that we free ourselves from worry and the insidious goals of bigger and more. Being free from fear means we acknowledge enough as the new abundance. When we are free from fear, rather than react, we mindfully act, consciously and powerfully choose a good greater than our individual selves. Which brings us to giving. Almsgiving is a basic duty of a believer. Material aid to those in need is a simple biblical command. It is not just philanthropy. It is a faithful gesture inspired by our response to God and God's love for us. Giving is central to every area of the work of love. With it, we know more peace, more joy, more hope. We care for and are in turn cared for. We can relax our shoulders and breathe. We can trust and continue to hope. Couched between that call to trust, a promise of provision, and an active posture to receive is the cure to what ails us. Giving. Giving works because all oppression is connected. And the great chasm that exists between those who have and those who have not should not exist. The lack of finances and resources can be debilitating. God wants us to see and set people free by responding. Giving, meeting the needs of the least of these, means we stand as revolutionaries, teachers, and leaders who partner with God as we work toward transformation of this world. Jesus tells us to sell and give always with this outward-looking stance and posture that is intentional about seeing our neighbors and meeting their needs. It's noticing who's absent from the conversation, who lacks the opportunity and resources, and doing what we can to right the wrongs. To, as Maya Angelou says, to be the rainbow on somebody's cloudy day. Pay it forward, notice, and then do something about it. This is no pie in the sky theology, one that will allow us to sit and wait for the solution someday, by and by. No, no, and no. It's an active spirituality, one that commands we go and do, sell and give. Do what you can in your part of the world to make things right. Mystic and theologian Howard Thurman reflects on possessions with these words, asking, can I put at the disposal of others my possessions, my money, my things? For what would I exchange my life? Would I exchange the resources of my mind and heart with others? Would I risk it to see and dream forward into what I say I commit myself to? Would I risk it? Would I risk it all to be free? Jesus says, relax into God's way of giving. Don't be so preoccupied with getting that you can't respond to God's giving. Because at the heart of this kind of giving is liberation. So be ready for it. God is quite specific about what our future looks like and invites us into the work of painting this picture, realizing this dream. But to make progress, we have to be just as specific. God tells us of God's expectation. The kingdom, he says, is like this. It is God reality, God initiative, God provision, and it is right now. It is intended for all, and this is how we go about making it happen. In the right here, the right now, everywhere, and all the time. God invites us into this adventure, so be ready and expect good. Expect and see God in everything. And yet being ready is a moment by moment way of choosing to live that places us in consistent alignment with God. Being on one's post faithfully means that there will be times when you must step away, trusting God to refresh and renew you. Being ready isn't a call to more anxiety. What causes fear? How can we be free from it? What is the source of our treasure? How do we honor the requirement to give in our own context? What is our current responsibility? How can we begin to imagine new ways of serving God, imaginings that make room for all of us? What kind of adaptations might be possible? What will we have to release? What are the possibilities? So here we have it. Multiple and mounting pandemics, war, the whittling away of our confidence in government and political leadership, multiple senseless school shootings and random violence, the loss of so much. If we're awake, we'll feel this critical push toward reflection and we will respond. So hear Jesus' words today. Releasing fear, letting go of fear to connect with our trust in God, having a balanced view of our possessions and being open and prepared to experience God activity is the pattern for discipleship. Being without fear, knowing the source of our treasure, our identity and worth, positions us to participate in and experience, to be prepared for us as an actual participant in God's dream, the kingdom of God. And so, if you are afraid, don't be afraid. Center your faith and trust in God. Give of your time and talent, your treasure for the benefit of all, and be ready. The time is now to, in word and deed, walk this out, to be inspired by the blessing that comes as we position ourselves for the road ahead. God's got us. But as the song says, we are the ones we've been waiting for.
In a time of impending darkness, these principles, these ways of being keep the eternal flame burning within us, the inner light glowing. We see with a greater sense of conscious awareness, an awareness that our survival depends on a courage tethered to our trust in God. We know a kingdom economy means we participate in the transference of resources so that there really is more love, so that there really is more peace, more joy, more hope, patience, more faith for all. This labor of love belongs to all of us. This is the hope of the gospel, the good news that compels us. It's the only news we need to rise, to grow into the call for a deeper relationship, one not with a God who hates us, but a God who loves us, a God for us. The God who begins with love and presses us to see with greater awareness that, in fact, the time to move, to act, is always right now. The emphasis on giving lay in the middle of the commands to release fear and be on your post. Giving, Jesus says, is the kindest thing we can do. It is the way we notice, the way we are charged to move through and care for this world. As we lean into this way of living, everything we need to understand will be revealed. But until then, we have this most basic plan. Jesus names the problem of fear and sets us up to live our way into a new and more hopeful story. Into this time of chaos and crisis, Jesus speaks the promises and presence of God and connects us with the God of provision, the God who offers the kingdom, sustaining, comforting, and nourishing us, being for us the river in the desert, a place of peace, a provider. Jesus wants us to see this plan for a way of living that simplifies our hurried and overprogrammed lives and helps us see clearly that God, the God, who as we align our hearts with this way of being, promises to show up. In the middle of it all, in the glorious ordinary of it all, as we align our hearts with this way of being, God promises to show up. So trust. Put away anxiety and fear of the future. Trust. Let the future rest in God's hands. Fear does not have to have the final say. Jesus makes plain the fact that our possessions, our worldly goods, the excess of food and clothing, money or riches, as they are hoarded for self-gain, mean nothing in God's kingdom. In fact, that hoarding and misplaced distribution of resources stands in direct opposition to the dream of God's kingdom. It impedes our true freedom. Giving keeps us connected to, in tune and time, with the great giver. So live with less. Live a life of giving. In today's reading, Jesus points to God's intimate and tender care, God's concern for us. Hear today the promise of love and blessing, and find your hearts rest in peace. As we close, I'll invite you into a time of reflection and prayer. We'll be still in the silence and spirit of this moment that we've created together to listen and hear from God. So I'll pose a few questions, but this time belongs to you. Spend a few moments allowing the Spirit to minister to you. Just listen. And so as you are able, I invite you to stand. And to, with this embodied action, tell God that we are here, that we want to be here, and that as we reflect on these prompts and questions, we're listening, we're ready, So maybe you'll place your palms across your heart, if that works for you. Maybe you'll allow your arms to rest at your sides with your palms facing forward. Find that comfortable position for your hands. Make that choice for yourself. Feel your legs strong beneath you. Connect the soles of your feet with the bottom of the floor. Maybe bend your knees slowly and then rise up into the strength of your legs. Engage your core. Lengthen your spine. Long neck, top of the head, the crown parallel with the ceiling. Maybe just circle your shoulders up, around, and back. And maybe you'll do that again because that felt good. And we'll just land right here. If you're comfortable in this moment and with this space and these people, maybe close your eyes. And if not, just find a soft gaze in front of you. Connect with your breath. And we'll do that with three rounds of breathing. Just inhale, exhale, nothing deep, nothing special. This is your God connection to your spirit, your breath. So just three breaths. We'll take it in together. And exhale. We'll repeat that. Inhale. And exhale. One last time together. Inhale. Little smile on your face and just arrive in this moment. Just be here, ready to listen, and ask yourself, just consider some of these questions. Am I living afraid? Am I free of fear? Or does fear hold me back from new gifts, new relationships, new experiences? Can I trust God's promise of provision for me? If I am afraid, to what am I grasping? And can I open my palms to release it? Can I be free to give and share? Am I truly seeing my family and friends, my community, those around me? Are my eyes open? What can I release that would support the flourishing of another? How am I, or how can I, be an active participant rather than a bystander in this beautiful work of love? What is mine to do? So these are just small little bite-sized chunks. is not our responsibility to save the entire world, but collectively, as we each take up our individual tasks, the work gets done. My mom likes to say, many hands make light work. And so what is yours to do? What is yours to give? What is yours to open your heart to receive? Just spend maybe 30 seconds here reflecting on any of those things, thinking about how you might be living afraid, thinking about how you can open yourself to give. In whatever way or shape that takes. And how can you be ready to notice, to be on your post, to do that kind of thing called God spotting, just noticing Jesus' activity everywhere. Help us to be ready to step in to do our part in helping to usher in this kingdom life, this kingdom of love and peace and justice, this world, this kingdom of healing and wholeness, the reconciliation with ourselves and others, the love that you have promised. Help us to receive it, Lord. Help us to share it. Help us to give it. Oh Lord, our souls wait for you. You are our help and our shield. Indeed, our hearts rejoice in you. For in your holy name we put our trust. So let your loving kindness, oh Lord, be upon us. Let it rest on us as we have put our trust in you. As we continue to put our trust in you, as we remain faithful, steadfast. Sometimes, Lord, we admit that the words, the actions sometimes feel insufficient, but right here, right now, we reclaim them. We reclaim these practices that are tried and true. If only everyone would live by just these three principles. Trusting you, giving to others, and being open to seeing you everywhere. Oh Lord, we love you. We commit our hearts to you today. And with this time that we spent together, we just say thank you. We thank you that you will do what only you can do in the way that only you can do it. We are humble participants, grateful participants, joyful participants. We stand in your grace. We marinate in it. We welcome your presence in here today. We feel it. And we thank you. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Amen. As I understand it, there's a prayer team here, so if anyone here needs or desires prayer that is available to you right now. I began my sermon today talking about how hard this life is right now. Some of us are pushing through it with this stance of, like, we're not going to be shaken. And that's just not real. We are feeling human beings, and God knows that. And we're here to be together, to experience this world together, to buoy each other, to carry each other, to lift each other. And so what is the point of it all if we're not going to use that? If we're not going to connect with each other and be together, to walk through the hard times together, to face the challenges together, as friends and family, as God's beloved, as God's people. So if you need prayer, accept it. Walk forward and receive it, or I believe the prayer team may be in the back. But please do, if you need that, if you want that, receive that grace. Opportunity to hear you today. And I don't ever get up here and preach without preaching to myself. And so I thank you for the word that has come forth, and I thank you that it has pricked the hearts that it needs to prick. And I thank you that you've allowed me to share space with this new family of mine. A blessing on you all.
So we wait.
bride.
Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be in church ready for you. Every heart longing for the King, we sing, even so come, Lord Jesus. So come, Lord Jesus, come.
Even so come.
Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Come. Thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free from our fears and sins, release us. Let us find our rest in thee, Israel's strength.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you always.